fellow YouTubers. And welcome again to this kind of quick video where I'm going to demonstrate how you can solar power an LCD, a little clock, from an LED. So, first of all, how did this come about? Well, more importantly, certainly a big acknowledgement to Sean back in Durban, South Africa. This is something he wrote to me about some time ago, and I added to my to-do list to kind of do a tutorial or demonstration on. Again, time hasn't allowed me, and then I was faced with a little challenge, and suddenly I remembered this email that Sean had sent me about LEDs and potentially what they can do. So let me tell you about the problem. As you know, I've been talking about testing different solar power products. So at the moment, I've got quite a few, and I'll give you a close-up when we do get to the bench. There's some solar power jars, if you like, one from South Africa, one I've just got here in the States, and then like this Energizer light, which got solar panels which can charge. And I want to check the manufacturer claims in terms of, for one, the robustness of the energy source, because particular this solar jar called the D-Lite claims it has a lithium battery inside it which never needs to be replaced. Now that's quite a heavy claim. I know the technologies which will be used, for instance, in this console glass solar jar, they will use kind of the normal AAA rechargeable batteries, which certainly over time, like your little solar lights, your garden lights, are going to die. So for one, I want to check the robustness of the energy source and then to see if they live up to the claims of the amount of light. This solar jar, they claim, will give you 8 hours of light on its low setting and 4 hours of light on its high setting. And for the first test, it's done that. But I want to cycle these a few times, and it's very difficult if I've got it in a dark room somewhere, 8 hours, how do I know exactly when, I can obviously check the time when it started, but when the test has stopped, I don't know, unless I happen to walk past within half an hour and go, oh, okay, it must have been roughly this time. So I wanted something to be able to sit there and measure the time by reading the light. Now I do have an X-Tech light meter, but that doesn't have any data logging feature. So the next thing I thought is, okay, well, I've got my Fluke 287, that can data log, but how can I get it to be receptive to light? Then I thought, okay, well, it measures voltage, so, and then the obvious thought is obviously attaching a little solar panel to it. But before that crossed my mind, that's when I suddenly remembered what Sean B. back in Durban had told me about LEDs. And believe it or not, that the little humble LED, besides when you apply power to it, it can produce light. If you send light back into it, it can produce power. So let's get onto the bench and have a look at that. Right, so I'll give you a quick run through the other devices I have just to show you what I've got under test, because they'll feature in future videos and we actually see how well they do work. So the one is this little Energizer lamp. It's got these, it's all LED driven, although these look like fluorescent tubes. They've got bright LEDs at the top and these tubes which disperse the light, and then a little night light over there. So it's got several modes. You can have on both sides, you've got the one side which works off solar power. And when I say solar power, it's the battery which has been charged by solar, or you can have normal batteries in here. So if your solar side runs out, then you can switch to your normal batteries if you're in an emergency situation. So if I go to the night light, you can see it's got that little night light, and then the full light, and that's also supposed to give you about 8 hours, as I recall. So that's one of the devices. The other I have shown some time ago. This I got at a show in South Africa. Console are a big, or the major glass producer in South Africa, and they came up with this concept. All the kind of electronics and battery and what have you are built into the top of this glass lid. It's got a magnetic switch, so that when you throw this little top over, it comes on, and then it lights up a glass jar. Now obviously it's a little bit vulnerable. It could be used for storage as well. But when you consider that basically a lot of the population in South Africa and around the world rely on paraffin lights or kerosene lights at night, for one, you're burning a fossil fuel. Two, in South Africa, every winter, those lights get knocked over during the course of the night and they can set a whole settlement on fire. Many people die. So this potentially can help for that. And then what drew me to the next one was a good friend of mine here in the States. sent me a link where, again, just having solar-powered streetlights at night meant some people in some settlement were not afraid to go out at night to go to the toilet, to go to the restroom or the toilet, because they were afraid previously. Lights can really change people's lives during the dark hours, whether it means being able to study or work or just get on with normal things. And obviously having a solar-powered source is really handy. So this is this other one, apparently a very robust, shatterproof. I've seen it drop from a third story. I'm getting another one of these, which is kind of similar in design to this, but it also has got USB charging to charge phones. So again, some other interesting devices. It can be charged from a USB device as well, but this has got the lithium batteries. So we're certainly gonna take this apart. I'm gonna test it. It's got two light settings, one, two, that's the brightest setting. And that's what I've been testing, and I've needed something to tell me how long it's working for. So let's have a closer look at the LEDs. Right then, so I say, when I first tested this, I was kind of really intrigued. I thought, I was quite surprised at the thought that these do actually can create energy and power. And obviously, they've got silicon inside them, and just like a solar cell, when light photons hit them, they're going to potentially excite the electrons and in a very simple way, obviously create electricity. But I didn't know how effective or how useful that would be. So if you note the meter, it's obviously fluttering around kind of in the noise zone. And when I connect this straight away, you can see it's already got 80 millivolts. It's bouncing around. And if I cup my hand over it, you can see certainly the light is having an effect. And even just with that range, because this meter is so sensitive on its data logging, I would be able to tell whether a light is going on and off, and thus obviously data log with it. But here's a surprise. Here's a handy torch again, which we're going to see more of with the battery testing. And as I switch that on, look at that. 1.3, almost 1.4 volts, and there's a very specific focal point, obviously just as you get it into the lens and it focals onto that very small junction that's inside there, that it kind of makes its maximum voltage and current. We'll look at the current. So that was the very surprising thing for me. So for that, I realized that, hey, you know, even at the sides, obviously it doesn't get as high a voltage, but nonetheless, it's picking up a voltage. So the obvious next thing for me was to see, well, are all LEDs equal? Do they produce the same voltage and potentially current? So let's just look at the other LEDs, right? So here we have green. And I'll put that on. And if you recall, the red was doing up close to about 80 millivolts when we started off. And if I put the light on there, that's producing 1.5. And let's see if I can hit a close to 1.6. And what I discovered was that by going through loads of red LEDs and loads of green ones, just like these different color LEDs, when you supply a current to them, produce different amount of light, the various different colored LEDs produce various voltages and currents. And I've gone through a whole range of them. They're not all exactly the same. Obviously, the junction or what have you inside might be slightly different. But on the whole, the reds tend to produce a similar voltage range. The blues, which is quite the interesting one, also produce a different voltage range. So here I have, if I remember correctly, it's a transparent blue LED. And already you can see just in the ambient light, it's producing about 170 millivolts. And that perhaps makes sense because it's obviously got a clearer kind of acrylic or the casing. Let's put some light onto it. 1.6. So certainly, again, not bad at all. Let's just try something a little bit bigger. Right here I have a rather large white LED. And there we go, we're hitting it. Sometimes it was even peaking at, if I point in the right direction, 633 towards the light, 600, 700, 800, 900, 1 volt already, just with the ambient light, 1.3. So, and if I put the torch on top of that and try and hit sweet spot, So I'm not achieving too much better with the torch on this one. So sometimes that sweet spot is like a very small focal point. I'm obviously using a bulb here which has got a few dark spots in it and focal points, so another light source might be better. But certainly, even as I hold it up to the ambient light, it's amazing to see how much this produces. So let's start looking at their current. Now then, I've got the Fluke set onto the microamps. Now I have, because of a concern about voltage drop at this on this setting, I have also gone and checked this on my Agilent, and the readings are fairly close. But at the same time, we're kind of trying to do a measure, a relative understanding. But I have gone and measured the kind of current consumption when this clock is running. Now this clock happens to come from a little kit I bought, again for potentially another demonstration. The actual kit is so you can power your clock from potatoes, but you're just using two dissimilar metals to produce, to form a battery. So this little clock will work off anything from at the bottom end about 1.5 microamps to at its best display around 3 microamps. So that's what we need to be produced from one of these LEDs at about 1 volt. So we've already got the voltage to run that, so now we just need to see if we've got the current. Can you believe it? We're already setting at 145 microamps just from shining a light onto this larger LED. Let's see how the others perform. Right, we're back to our initial green one. Certainly not as effective as that big white one, but nonetheless, it's producing probably just about enough to actually power up that clock potentially. So there we go, let's move on to the red. Right, we have our red, and that's producing a fair bit more. Look at that, 8. Obviously just hit the focal point, the kind of focal point in the right place over there. But certainly, there you go, 7, I can consistently get 7, 6, 7, 4 out of it. So this potentially could also power that clock. Let's go back to the clear blue. Right, we've got the clear blue. Look at that. 40, 20, certainly I can consistently get in the 20s, 20 microamp, 30 odd. So almost that big clear white one seems like overkill when potentially this little beastie could actually power that clock. So let's hook it up in a circuit and see if we can actually get that clock to work. Right then, so I've got everything set up. I know it's not too visible here, but obviously the clear LED is sat over there. I've got the voltage measurement over here, so we can see that at least I'm hitting the right voltage, and then the clock over here. So the first thing I'm going to do is apply the light. And there we go, you can actually see the LCD, we have got something happening. As you can see from the Fluke, we have got the correct voltage, certainly, because this will work anywhere up to about two, anywhere from 1 to 2.5. There we go, it almost started up. So what's my problem? The electronics in the actual clock itself obviously want a fairly consistent straight switch on voltage, and this I've discovered obviously from playing with other solar powered bits and pieces. And this is something as well that we need to be aware of. When you have a power supply which switches on, you can't have a very kind of slow ramp up of your voltage, because potentially, particularly microelectronics or ICs, want a good voltage to start operating, and given the slow ramp up might put them into a kind of gray phase, or they may not work properly. So how on earth do we get around that? Well, the one way is to potentially add a little bit of a battery. So what I tried with this is I've got a little electrolytic, just a 220 microfarad capacitor. Now I know also from experience that by putting it in and slowly allowing this to charge up, if it does charge up, again that's just applying slow voltage to the clock. So we have to disconnect the clock, see if this will charge up, and then apply the actual power supply to the clock. Right, so I've got the capacitor connected. I've actually disconnected the positive terminal of the clock itself. So everything's on the breadboard. It's just connected up in parallel, and obviously because it's electrolytic, the polarity is important. There's the LED, there's the capacitor, and I've got this wire across it to short it out to ensure that there's no charge in there. Now, before I even get the actual torch and start to shine it on there, I'm going to disconnect the short, and I want you to note what's already happening. So even just with that sitting in ambient light, that little LED is already charging that capacitor. And I mean, I was really surprised when I saw this. So if we get the actual torch and shine the torch on there, you'll see that in no time how quickly the voltage shoots up in that little capacitor. So we'll let it get to whatever the LED will fully charge it to. So there we go. I mean, it's charged up to like a AA cell. It's got about 1.6 volts. It obviously isn't carrying much charge, but let's see if that's able to run the actual clock. So I'm now going to connect the positive terminal of the clock back up. Bang. And there you go. That is now running off the charge that was generated by that LED into the capacitor. And as you can see, obviously the voltage is dropping. And if I'm just shy of hands, let's see if I can get that there. If I actually put the torch over there now, look at the voltage. I'm actually supplying more current than is being used by the actual clock itself. So within a reasonable amount of ambient light, potentially let's say even with that bigger white LED, that would then allow just a single LED to charge a capacitor and run a clock. And I must say, I was quite amazed at that. Simple, silly little thing perhaps, but I thought might be of interest to people, could be interesting to experiment with about at home. And this is certainly something which is safe and easy to try at home. There could be potential lots of little fun experiments you could do. You could go and link all these up in series to provide higher voltage, or in parallel potentially to try and provide more current. So there's a fair bit of experimentation. And then perhaps, obviously, the one challenge here is to provide a way of switching the power on at the right voltage, because you don't want to have a little switch or crocodile clip that you want to switch across. So how could you do that? And there, potentially something like a transistor or a FET might be the answer. But there you go. And just before we end off, again, all of this kind of is going to working with my kind of mini solar power projects. One of those being, as I've mentioned before, is the solar powered Kindle. And this package arrived not too long ago from, as you can see, Lemoore Fried, obviously Adafruit Industries. So in here, I've got a number of items. I've got their kind of their little USB charger for, it's a DC to DC converter, which runs off, boosts a low voltage to a higher voltage. So that's something I'm going to be experimenting with the solar powered Kindle. As well, they've got this kind of solar powered little circuit board for charging. It's a solar LiPo charger, and they claim it doesn't do true MPPT, but it certainly does track and try and adjust for the ideal conditions of the solar power that you attach to it. And this is one of the projects which really got me interested in Arduino, because I wanted to build an MPPT charge controller. And there is a project by Kibi on my forum where he's got that and taken the design from somewhere else and played around in his own way. But this is something I'm really keen to play with and see how it develops. I've got a little LiPo battery, because ultimately I want to use super or hybrid capacitors, but I also am going to obviously play around with this technology, because at the moment this is probably where the best energy density lies. And then I've got a host of little solar panels, and I'm making some interesting little discoveries myself in terms of what are the most sufficient or efficient solar panels for these kinds of projects, but we'll touch base on that soon. So there you go. It may not have any real serious real world applications, but I thought a fun one nonetheless, and certainly is going to provide a very simple solution for me, as opposed to having to use a solar panel stuck in a room or a kind of confined space monitoring these lighting devices. I can just take this to the light device, and that'll more than give me enough reference on my Fluke 287 to provide me with a time frame for how long those lights are lasting. And potentially you could have a lot of fun with a little simple thing like this. So again, thanks very much to Sean in Durban. But anyway, some interesting little projects on the go, and I say, even the simple ones can be quite enlightening. Thanks very much for watching, and I'll catch you soon. Cheers.